My name is Walt Kester, and I'll be presenting this section on instrumentation, tests, and measurement solutions and methods. The basic agenda today is to understand challenges of precision data acquisition in several different sensing applications. And we've chosen three different ones. One is a complex impedance measurement system. The second has to do with using accelerometers to measure tilt. And the third is how to design precision weigh scale signal conditioning circuitry. So there's some wide variety of measurement techniques involved here, and I think they're going to illustrate some important principles. We're going to illustrate these using our Circuits from the Lab signal chain solutions, which are basically reference designs which consist of hardware, complete description of the circuit, how it works, what the design principles are, documentation, and also design files that are available for download to allow you to look at the PC board layout, bill of materials, complete schematic, Gerber files, assembly drawings, and also some software that allows you to use LabVIEW software to interface the hardware with a standard PC so that you can perform circuit evaluations. Now, to get the data from the circuit reference design board to the PC, we have two approaches. We have a simple serial SDP board, or we have the one that's based on the Blackfin, which allows parallel interfacing to the USB and also many other types of interfaces. So you'll be getting the evaluation board, the reference design, plus either the full-blown or the serial version of the SDP board. So that tells you basically what the Circuit from the Lab reference design is. So we're going to go into this impedance measurement application first. And impedance measurement has a lot of applications in measuring liquid quality, oil in the engine, the how much longer you can go before you need to change it, and especially in biomedical now, where you can look at the resistance and impedance of tissue, blood, and determine quite a bit about the health of the tissue and also of the body and the blood flow. Also industrial applications, which I mentioned. So to measure a complex impedance, and I'm not talking just about measuring resistance, I'm looking at the complete network. I want to be able to measure the equivalent complex impedance of a network. So to do that, I'm going to have to generate a sine wave, sweep it over a number of different frequencies, measure the voltage across the network, and measure the current. Both need to be measured in terms of complex quantities, and based on that I can actually calculate the impedance over frequency of the circuit. So to do that, I'm going to need some sort of a direct digital synthesizer, or DDS, to generate the different frequencies. Some sort of filter, a buffer, I'm going to take that and drive it into the network. Then I need to put a sense resistor in so I can measure the current through the network, convert that back into a voltage, measure that with an A to D, measure both the voltage and the current with an A to D, and then perform some sort of a frequency analysis using a DSP. So all of this takes quite a bit of hardware. We have a single chip solution, the 805933, which will do all of that in one chip. So in this chip, the impedance converter, we have the DDS core, we have a DAC, we have a driver which drives the excitation frequency into the unknown impedance. We have a current to voltage converter so that we can look at the current. And we have an amplifier, a low pass filter. We have a 12-bit A to D, and then we do a discrete Fourier transform, a 1024-point discrete create, transform, get the real and imaginary part of this at each frequency, put that into a simple I2C interface to get it in and out of the PC to actually look at the impedance. So this works okay for impedances between 1K to 10 megohms. It's 12-bit resolution and 100 kilohertz maximum excitation frequency. The DFT is done internally. You don't have to perform that externally. It's pretty much a single chip solution to this problem. Now, we need to know the approximate value range of this unknown impedance, because you can see that if we overdrive this input, if we pump too much current in here, we can have a saturation problem out here. So it's not going to be able, you're not going to be able to just put any impedance in there. You have to be able to bound it, and you have to know approximately what the magnitude is going to be, at least within an order of magnitude, so that you don't get into issues with the amplifier. We look at the reference design board that actually uses this. We have the impedance converter, and we have the interface hardware that allows you to interface this to the PC over the USB port. So this is a simple block diagram of what's on the actual board. On the reference design, we've added a buffer to the output voltage, and we've added another buffer on the current conversion side, so that we can take the current, convert it into voltage using this external current to voltage converter, and then drive that into the actual circuit. This allows us to make impedance measurements below 1K ohm. And the op amp is a 808605. So now we need to calibrate the circuit. This shows what we've done. We've calibrated it using approximately 100 K ohm calibration resistor. And we can, if we calibrate it with 100 K calibration resistor, we show here we can go all the way down into the several K ohms and still maintain accurate results. So usually one calibration is good for a fairly wide range of impedances. This shows what a complex impedance would look like, where we put a capacitor in parallel with a resistor. So you start out basically at low frequencies measuring the resistor value, and as the frequency is swept, the impedance drops because of the lower impedance of the capacitor. And this circuit allows you, as I said, to go down to 10.3 ohms from 30 ohms, and also down to 1 microfarad. So you do have to switch the calibration resistor in and out, and if you want to do that in your system, we have a large number of FET switches which would be suitable for that, with on resistances of a half an ohm or less. So the switch resistance would not affect the measurement in most applications. So this basically shows the software display that you would get after doing the sweep. This shows the hardware. This is where you would put your own unknown impedance. So it's a neat solution to a problem that could involve quite a bit of hardware if you didn't have that integrated solution. There's another application that we found in measuring the impedance of blood, and this is important because if you look at the impedance of blood over a period of time, you can tell what the clotting factor is and how well the blood actually clots. So hemophiliacs, this would show that up really, really quickly. This is a little bit different circuit. We've got the unknown impedance here referenced to ground, and so for this case, we're going to take the output, buffer it, drive it through a very low value sense resistor into the unknown impedance, and we're going to get the current through the impedance by measuring the voltage across the small sense resistor and amplifying it with a traditional instrumentation amplifier and passing that back into the current input of the 805933. So this shows basically a slide which has blood smeared on it, and we look over time, we look at the impedance as a function of time, and for the case of healthy blood, we reach a value where the impedance begins to level off. For blood that does not clot properly, we have this black curve where the impedance continues to change. And this was written up in one of the analog dialogue articles referenced here. So if you want to measure the conductance or impedance of a liquid, you would put the probes down into the liquid. You can measure not only the resistance of the liquid, but also any capacitive effects which may be due to metallic content in the liquid. And as I mentioned, you might want to use the external switches, using CMOS switches in order to switch between the calibration and the unknown impedance. So it's a neat little circuit. The next topic we're going to look at is tilt, completely different topic. And we're going to be using accelerometers to do this. Well, why use accelerometers? Why not just use a potentiometer attached to a pendulum? Well, we think we're not going to use these mechanical techniques, which are subject to wearing out. There's a lot of reasons not to do it that way. MEMS accelerometers are proven technology because they've been used in airbag crash detectors for years. So we've got lots of reliability built into our accelerometers. They give good accuracy, they don't take up much board area, low power, and they give some very good advantages when you look at measuring tilt. You can find these in patient monitors, car alarms, laptop computer disk drive protectors, just so many different applications. And we have accelerometers that range anywhere from low G, plus or minus 2G, all the way up to over 100G. Usually for tilt measurements, we would stick with the low G accelerometers. So what would we want in a tilt measurement? Well, we certainly want to be able to measure a full 360 degrees, maybe an output error of less than a half a degree, single supply, low power. This particular reference design, circuit note 189, shows a complete signal chain solution for a dual-axis tilt measuring system. So let's look at the principle of operation of these accelerometers first. And this is a very simplified view, but the micromachine technology allows us to construct these little beams and these tethers so that as acceleration is applied in either direction, the beam actually moves back and forth proportional to the acceleration. And what we're going to do is measure the capacitance between the beam and the plates here, the fixed outer plates. Normally, with no acceleration, this would be in the center, so these two small capacitors would be equal. However, if you apply acceleration in either direction, one of the capacitors gets bigger and the other gets smaller. So by measuring that differential capacitance, you can determine, you can relate it back to the amount of acceleration. So the signal processing on this is fairly straightforward. In most cases, we'll use an oscillator which gives a square wave output, both outputs, one of which is 180 out of phase with the other. So if I have essentially equal capacitance between these two plates, CS1 and CS2 are equal, then these signals cancel each other and I have no output. If there is a difference between the capacitance values, then I'll either get a positive going series of pulses or a negative going series of pulses. And I can use a simple synchronous demodulator to convert that into a voltage output. Some of the accelerometers go a step further, convert this into PWM output, and some actually have an internal EDC to convert it to a digital word. So if I'm going to use an accelerometer to measure tilt using just a single axis accelerometer, this is what I'd have. As I go from 0 degrees, I have essentially no acceleration, and I go to 90 degrees, I have essentially 1 G of acceleration. I go to negative 90 degrees, I have negative 1 G of acceleration. So this follows a sine wave function, and the accuracy at the peaks is somewhat limited. The other thing is I don't have any way of knowing if I'm over in this region or this region, so I really don't have a full 360 degree capability here. So if I look at the dual axis approach that I show here, essentially I have the two accelerometers offset by 90 degrees, so that when one accelerometer is at the peak, the other is at zero. So if I combine the outputs, then I can get sensitivity across the full 360 degree range. So the ADXL203 is a dual axis accelerometer, has the two accelerometers offset by 90 degrees, an amplifier, a demodulator, and two output amps, one for the X and one for the Y output voltage, and also a series resistance to allow you to do external noise filtering. And this is the reference design board for circuit note CN189, which is in the demo exhibit area, where we put the ADXL203 on the board, and we have the serial version of the SDP board, which is used to interface to the PC. Now this is the circuit. The conditioning is fairly straightforward because we have for a 5-volt supply, we have an output voltage swing at each one of the X and Y outputs between 1.36 volts to 3.64 volts. And the input to the A to D converter that we've chosen is 0 to 3.3 volts. So we need to level shift and attenuate this signal so that it fits within the range of the A to D converter input channels. So this is done fairly simply with two stages of attenuation using a standard non-inverting op-amp configuration, where when it comes out of the second amplifier, we've changed the common mode voltage from 2.5 to 1.7, and the signal swing is from 0.2 to 3.2, which is within the 0 to 3.3 volt range of the 7887. So we use a quad op amp because we need to do the same thing in the second channel: low bias current, low power current, and a 12-bit SAR converter to do the analog to digital conversion. So this shows just what we would get if we used a simple inverse sine output, just using the X output. And if we could do the inverse cosine output on the Y axis, and we still have a problem either at the plus or minus 90 degree point in the case of the arc sine output, and at zero in the case of the arc cosine output. But let's be smart and let's combine these outputs, since we've got the X and the Y, and let the output equal to the arc tangent of X over Y. And if we do that, we have the full sensitivity over the full range, and we also pick up our ability to go the full 360 degrees. This shows basically what the software will do. It'll actually, we've got this mounted on a wheel, and if you turn the wheel, you can see the angle change. So it's a neat demo, and it's in the exhibition area. The reference design contains the complete schematic, bill of materials, pads, Gerber layouts, assembly drawings, and also the software needed to interface it to the PC and give this type of display. All right, the last topic we're going to talk about is probably one of the more difficult ones, and this is design of a precision load cell or a precision weigh scale. A weigh scale is basically a precision scale that uses a load cell as the basic resistive measurement element. We'll look at Wheatstone bridge solutions, low-level signal conditioning. The noise-free code resolution is important in this type of system. Sigma-delta versus SAR converters. How to use high-performance instrumentation amps, and also how to use a completely integrated solutions using the sigma-delta converters with built-in PGAs. So looking at sensors that are resistive-based, and there are lots of these, we have the strain gauges, load cells, which are made up of combinations of strain gauges, pressure sensors. All of these are resistive-based devices. And typically, one of the ways to measure unknown resistance accurately is to use the Wheatstone bridge, which I'm sure all of you are very familiar with. Wheatstone bridges typically can be driven either with voltage as a current. This shows a voltage drive. We can have a single element. We can have two elements varying in a couple of different combinations, and also four elements varying. And there are equations that describe the nonlinearity of all of these. The same thing is true of a current drive, slightly different equations, but the idea of using one, two, or four elements as varying elements is fairly standard. So if we want to drive the bridge with a voltage drive, and this depends on the type of bridge. For instance, some pressure sensors are specified for current drive, some for voltage drive. So we look at the voltage drive first. We need a precision voltage source, a buffer. We drive out to the remote sensor through the force lead. We bring back a sense lead so that we can eliminate the problem due to the voltage drop in the lead resistance. We have the current flow in here. We have no current essentially in the sense line. So this eliminates the error due to this voltage drop. We do the same thing on the negative end with a buffer amp. So using a six lead Kelvin sensing for the bridge, you've got two lines directly for the bridge output, and then you have the four wire force and sense configuration. So that Kelvin configuration is used on many of the precision load cells. To generate a constant current drive, you can use a reference voltage and a sense resistor down here. So we drive the voltage into the bridge, and the current is forced to equal the reference voltage divided by the sense resistance. And that's independent, essentially, of the lead resistance. So current drive, as I mentioned, is common in certain types of pressure sensors. Look at the type of A to D that you would use in these systems. Sigma Delta is good for the high resolution industrial applications. There's a crossover point between Sigma Delta and 16-bit SAR converters, which also have some applications here. And of course, the pipeline converters are limited for use primarily for high speed video and IF sampling type applications. So typically, you'd choose more than likely a Sigma Delta converter or perhaps a SAR converter for most of these precision weigh scale applications. SAR versus Sigma Delta. SAR converters, fast settling, good for multiplexed applications, no pipeline delay. You give it a convert start pulse, the data comes out corresponding to that convert start. Fairly easy to use, minimal programming, usually needs an external instrumentation amp, The analog filter for the anti-aliasing filter can be a little bit difficult in some applications. Sigma delta, you have the big digital filter, which limits settling time. It's limitations to some degree in multiplexed applications. More programming required. They do have, in many cases, internal PGAs, which have some real advantages and get rid of external instrumentation amps. The internal digital filter can be designed to remove pretty much completely power line noise, and oversampling relaxes the requirements on the analog anti-aliasing filter. There's other pros and cons of one versus the other, but I think this pretty much is all you need to know for right now. We're not going to really dwell on sigma delta concepts. It's been written up in a lot of the literature and the references at the end of the this particular presentation you can look at. I'll just show you traditional Nyquist operation where we're sampling at FS. The bandwidth of interest is FS over 2. Quantization noise is equal to the least significant bit divided by square root of 12. If we oversample by a factor of K, follow it by a digital filter, we can remove the noise that occurs between FS over 2 and KFS over 2 and increase the signal-to-noise ratio. If we use noise shaping with the sigma delta modulator combined with digital filter and decimation, we can not only remove the noise in this region here, but we can shove most of the quantization noise out of the bandwidth of interest and into the bandwidth where we're going to filter it. So this is how sigma delta converters pick up lots of resolution using oversampling and noise shaping without actually having to have complicated conversion techniques. This is a sigma delta modulator, a first order modulator. The analog circuit and the digital circuitry that generates the noise shaping function. So the benefits of sigma delta, you can get up to 24 bits or so of no missing code resolution, 19 or so noise-free code resolution, which we'll talk about in a minute, good accuracy, lots of digital stuff, not as much analog stuff. Oversampling and digital filtering will give you a good line rejection, and you get the wide dynamic range and relatively low cost, since these highly digital parts can run on fairly low cost CMOS processes and don't really require laser trimming. Lots of applications for sigma delta converters and process control sensors and instrumentation. What we're going to look at is precision weigh scale applications where you're looking at maybe measuring very small amounts of weight sitting on top of a large weight. And in this case, we picked a two kilogram full scale, and we want to be able to measure 100 milligram resolution. That's not an unreasonable requirement. 2 kilogram full scale, 0.1 gram sensitivity. So if we look at a load cell, traditional easily available load cell, the full load for this one is 2 kilograms, sensitivity is 2 millivolts per volt. So if I have a 5-volt excitation, my full-scale output is 10 millivolts. Impedance 350 ohms, and it can be made up of basically the concept is four strain gauges mounted and connected in a bridge configuration. So when I apply the weight, the top two resistors decrease, the bottom two resistors increase, and that all goes in the bridge and creates the 10 millivolt full-scale output for the 5-volt excitation. Now, noise plays a big part in the ability of the least significant bits to be observed on a display, for instance. So noise for these types of parts can be characterized as an ideal converter with input noise summed in with the actual input. So you typically would have a Gaussian distribution which has an RMS value and a peak-to-peak value. And usually the rule of thumb is the peak-to-peak is 6.6 times the RMS. So if I ground the input of one of these high-resolution converters, I'm going to see a distribution of codes around a common center code. So let's look at the requirement here. To measure 100 milligrams out of 2 kilograms, that basically says that we need to have we need to divide this 2,000 gram range into 20,000 individual noise-free levels. So if I have 20,000 noise-free counts, and I just go down and I take the base 2 logarithm of that, I'm going to come up with noise-free bits of 14.3. In order to resolve 100 milligrams out of 2 kilograms, I need essentially 14.3 noise-free bits. Now, noise-free bits, effective resolution, this is where some specsmanship comes into play, and we need to go through that. Okay, starting out with the full-scale range, I've got a certain amount of RMS noise. If I divide the full-scale range by the RMS noise and take the base 2 log of that, I come up with a term we define as effective resolution. If I take the full-scale range and I divide it by the peak-to-peak input noise, I get the term noise-free code resolution. And the peak-to-peak noise is 6.6 times the RMS noise. So the noise-free code resolution is the base 2 log of the full-scale range divided by 6.6 times the RMS noise, which is equal to the effective resolution minus 2.72 bits. So if I know the effective resolution, I can subtract 2.72 bits to get noise-free code resolution. In most cases, noise-free code resolution is what you're really more interested in. But you really need to be careful on the data sheets because in some cases, manufacturers like to specify the effective resolution first because it's 2.72 bits greater than the noise-free code resolution. So watch out for that. So for peak-to-peak noise, you're going to see the terms noise-free code resolution, noise-free bits, flicker-free bits, peak-to-peak resolution. All that's associated with peak-to-peak. RMS noise, you'll see the terms effective resolution, RMS resolution, but the term effective number of bits or e-knobs, that's got to do with the high-speed converters with sine wave inputs. That's not really what we're talking about with effective resolution. So don't get that mixed in with these precision terms. So if we have a full-scale output of 10 millivolts, that's really a problem. To digitize that to high resolution, just by the fact of the noise associated with the converter and amplification and whatnot. So the traditional approach, use an in-amp for gain and then go into a SAR converter. Pick a really good in-amp, pick a good SAR converter, or a sigma-delta converter for that matter. You'll probably be able to get maybe 12 noise-free bits out of this approach. At the best. Maybe some variation in this, but typically that's what you're going to wind up with. Now we can use the differential inputs of the SAR sigma delta converters and get rid of this output gain stage or output difference amplifier and go directly from a gain stage into the differential inputs. If we do this approach, we can get up to maybe 15 noise-free bits. If we take a sigma-delta converter that has a built-in PGA, on the other hand, which is the ultimate solution, we can generally get maybe 16 or so noise-free bits for a 10 millivolt full scale. So looking at this circuit, this uses an instrumentation amplifier, circuit note 216, the load cell signal conditioning. This is the SDP board. This is the actual reference design board. We look at the simplified schematic. We have the bridge driving the gain stage, which is a gain of 375. We go into the 24-bit sigma delta converter through some good filtering to knock out the high frequency noise, both around the gain stage as well as at the differential and common mode inputs of the converter. So the input range of the converter is 10 volts peak to peak, but we're only using 3.75 volts for the 10 millivolt full scale. So using that particular circuit, we can get 15.3 noise-free bits, which is really pretty good. This shows you the eval board, the SDP board, and the display that you get with the software that that comes with the board. Now, there's another approach here where we go directly into a high-resolution sigma-delta converter, the 7190, which has a built-in PGA. Now, the gain of the PGA can go as high as 128. So with a gain of 128 on the PGA, this particular circuit can give you some really high noise-free resolution, and it doesn't require any external instrumentation amplifier. The other nice thing about this circuit is it's ratiometric. In other words, I'm driving the converter with the 5-volt supply. The same supply that drives the bridge is also the reference to the converter, so that as the 5 volts changes, the reference changes and the amplitude on the output changes, so everything is ratiometric and the converter essentially will measure the same value. So you'll find that ratiometric principle used in lots of these applications. So this particular converter, as we mentioned, it has the input buffer, either can be switched in or out. It's got the ratiometric capability. It has an input multiplexer, so if you wanted to use another channel, you could. The built-in PGA, it's automatic calibration, several modes. Chopping options allow you to minimize the effects of very small error voltages due to parasitic thermocouples. And this is an example, the reference design circuit note 102, a precision weigh scale system using that AD7190 will give you about almost 17 noise-free bits, which is really, really good. And this is the basic circuit for the 7190 based weigh scale processor. We do use a separate regulator to drive the digital part of the converter. You know, this is all to minimize the effects of noise, because when you're looking at 16 or 17 bits noise-free resolution for a 10 millivolt full scale, every bit of noise in the system can do damage. So this is run off of a battery. The battery drives the two regulators. The regulators drive the bridge as well as the converter. And we have lots of filtering on the reference input as well as the analog input in order to get rid of external noise. And the filter, the digital filter, has been selected and then programmed so that the zeros occur at 50 hertz in the case of this particular part. You can adjust it to 60 hertz also. So just looking at the data sheet, and this is what you may see on these converter data sheets, you've got the RMS noise as a function of the gain and as a function of the output data rate. So in this case, we're going to use the 4.7 hertz output data rate and a gain of 128. So that says we have 8.5 nanovolts RMS noise. For a gain of 128, a reference of 5 volts, the full scale is going to be 80 millivolts peak to peak at the input. So, but we're only using 10 millivolts out of the 80 millivolt range. So there we have a 3-bit loss in effective resolution because of not utilizing the full range of the converter. So we go to this table, and for a gain of 128, we have 20.5 noise-free bits. That's the terms in parentheses. This is noise effective resolution, and this is noise free resolution. So 20.5 has to be reduced by 3 bits because of not using the full range. So we theoretically, with this converter, we should be able to get 17.5 noise free bits for a 10 millivolt peak to peak input. In practice, actually connected up to the load cell, we get 16.8 bits of noise-free code resolution, which is really pretty good compared to the 17.5 noise-free bits that we would get if we only used the A to D by itself, essentially. So this shows the basic hardware. We have the battery mounted on the board. To minimize noise effects, we have the weigh scale, the load cell, and we show the display here with the software. You can look at the peak-to-peak value of the noise, actually look at the noise samples, or you can get a histogram distribution of the noise. And the board has complete design files, schematic, bill of materials, PADS layout, Gerber file, and assembly drawing. So we've gone through this section actually fairly quickly, and we've talked about, first of all, making the complex impedance measurements using the integrated solution that has the built-in DDS, and all you need to measure complex impedance. That demonstration is in the exhibit area. We talked about measuring tilt using dual-axis accelerometers, the advantages of dual versus single, some accelerometer conditioning circuitries, and then some really high precision applications using the load cells as an example. These circuit note 216, that circuit is in the exhibition area. The bridge fundamentals, sigma-delta fundamentals, the noise consideration, especially understanding what we mean by noise-free code resolution versus effective resolution, how to use the external instrumentation amps, and how to use the fully integrated solution using the integrated PGA as part of the sigma-delta converters. This is the hardware for the impedance measurement circuit. This is the hardware for the tilt measurement circuit. And this is the hardware for the weigh scale demonstration in the exhibition room. So at the end of this presentation, there are some good references on sigma delta converters, some good references on the weigh scale applications, and also some good references on accelerometers. So I hope you've enjoyed it, and I hope you go to the exhibition area and see the demos. Thanks.